Hey everybody, so this is a research paper that I want to talk about for different reasons than I normally talk about on this channel. And this research paper is called Forward-Only Learning for Orthogonal Neural Networks of Any Depth. And it's put out by a slew of, like a couple of companies, as well as like a few universities out of France. And then the thing that I want to highlight and note within this research paper, so I mean, like, there will be times throughout my career on this channel, etc., where like I will like knock academia overall, right? And more often than not, I praise academia. I try to do that. I try to balance it. But to me, the problem within academia is that like it's a problem like of like everyone rushes to publish, and it's not a problem with just academia, right? This is a problem like across the board, it's a like a problem with a culture, U.S. culture, I would say, overall, where it's in academia it showcases itself as a rush to publish, right? Just like to prove that you can do anything unique, right? Like this is the different than what is the baseline, and then so therefore because it's different, like, and we can prove that it's different, and we can prove on some benchmarks that it works in a different way, then like you should look at us because we're doing something different than anybody else, right? And then that, to me, it's when you do that like too many times, it creates the problem that we're in now, right? Like, I understand 1,000,000% why people don't have a lot of trust in AI overall, like, in the field, because there's too many people that, I mean, flat out, like, they put out, and it starts with research, right? And then so when you put out research papers along these lines, and then within these claims, and then framing them the explicitly the way that this research paper does, which is why I'm calling it out, right? Then that's what leads to problems. And then my claim within this particular video is that this particular research paper is framing their claims in a very, in a way that makes it basically untrue, makes their arguments untrue overall, right? Let's jump to the conclusion, flat out. Like, that's what my hypothesis is. And then some conclusion. They create this algorithm called Photon, and we'll dive into that, right? The Photon algorithm proposed in this work emerges as a promising forward-only alternative to conventional backpropagation. It successfully solves the main limitation of backpropagation, which is the scalability to deep networks, resorting to the orthogonal constraint to provide a meaningful error signal to the network. We showed the ability of Photon not only to learn better than the standard shallow algorithm in most standard backpropagation in most shallow settings, but also to scale deeper to deeper networks and to be competitive with backpropagation on the task tested. We further show that Photon can be adapted to convolutional neural networks, opening up the possibility of applying it to more diverse architectures. And then so like that's their framework, right? That it can it competes with, and it can perform better overall than conventional backpropagation. And then they give some, like, so let's look through their benchmarks, right? And then so that claim, like, what their conclusion, their claim in the conclusion is like not accurate to me, is what I'm going to state overall, right? And then so they do it first on this this learning test. And then they do it through a small number of layers, right? And then so what you can see here up front on the test, so when you're looking at like 1 to 2 layers, or like 1 to 3 layers, we'll call it, it scores very high. But when you see like when it goes up to like 50 layers deep, their accuracy on their own test plummets dramatically, right? So their claim is that this algorithm solves that deep layer problem, but it doesn't, like, it even in their own tests it doesn't, right? And then so I don't need to do a lot around that, because like, so let's go to their next test, right? And then same thing here, you can see like with so the CIFAR 10 and the CIFAR 100 tests on their own tests, so it's, they're showcasing that it's getting like a 55 on the with one singular layer, but then it drops 15% in accuracy down to 40 with 50 layers deep. And then on SciFar 100, the top was a 27, and then same thing, almost 15 point difference, like half the performance. 15, it gets a 15 when you get to 50 layers deep. And then that's the same thing that came about all throughout my experiments within this. But the bottom line that I want to point out within this is that these numbers overall as well, they're cherry picking these numbers, is like the bottom line that I want to point out within this is showcasing. And then so like you can see that like what I'm talking about within this, starting to see within these cosine similarity experiments, where you can see like this, like so like especially these ones like here at the bottom, like where you're getting like this bottom row here of the case of the stable training, like this isn't stable training, right? This is not what I would expect from a stable training mechanism. And then same thing here, right? Like we can see like these graphs are weird overall, as far as these cosine similarity charts, and then the orthogonalization rate and the update, like so like the accuracy in their charts that they're showing here goes directly against their conclusion. Again, their conclusion states that they solve this for depth. But what we can see is these are their own experiments and their own charts, right? And the accuracy on these experiments drops significantly on depth within this. So like, their own experiments and their own charts don't support their conclusion overall. And then I run tests on this algorithm as well, right? And then so this research paper interested me and it caught my eye because like, I agree with this camp, right? So this backpropagation camp exists because of the fact that very simplistically and overall that backpropagation doesn't exist in any sort of biological organism, right? There's no natural process that we can look towards and then say, hey, it actually uses backpropagation. And it's because it's not real world, right? The example that I kind of utilize for that and frame it in overall is that like utilitarianism would be the most perfect ethical framework to ever exist, but the problem is that you can't know what the outcome is of something before you actually go through that moral ethical step, right? Whereas backpropagation is like literally the exact opposite of that. That's exactly what it does. And then so inherently because of that, it's not real world. It's not a real world learning mechanism because you can never know upfront what the consequences of something are going to be before you actually perform the action, right? And then the backpropagation needs that consequence upfront to essentially like backpropagate over the action, right? And then so that's the knock that people have within it. And then so within that, everyone has been looking towards like a forward only algorithm. And then so this forward only algorithm is like a holy grail type of algorithm, which is why they make this paper, right? And then so their claim within this paper is pretty significant overall. Like what they're trying to say that like solves this problem overall, because so this problem has existed since the 1980s, but the problem has been is that any sort of attempt at this type of algorithm, this forward only algorithm, is always beaten by this. And then so the argument is like this doesn't exist in nature, but this just absolutely like wrecks anything else that is in the camp of this. And then the research paper is saying, hey, we've solved this. And then I'm saying, like, hey, wait a minute. and then that's kind of where we're at within this, right? And then so my experiment was I trained just a standard CNN model on MNIST, and then I did backpropagation versus their method, their photon method, right? And then I initially trained for three epochs, and then this is the pattern that came out, and then so I wanted to bump it up to make 100% sure before I made this, so I trained it for 20 epochs each. And then 20 epochs each, the backpropagation model here, the standard backpropagation, it did exactly what I expected it to. And then starts at 99.19, basically 99.19 and ends up at 99.88. In terms of like accuracy and then training accuracy and then test accuracy, it ends up at 99.16, where it started at 99.03. The photon training starts at 91.73 and ends at 92.17. And then you have a lot of fluctuations within there. And then very specifically, when we look at the test accuracy overall, there's a few things that emerge within this. The best pattern that emerges to me overall is this. And we're looking at these numbers here on the far right, right? And then so what you see here is that it goes from, on Epoch 14, it has a test accuracy of 91.48. And then it goes down to its worst accuracy across any of these on Epoch 15 with a test accuracy of 84.3. And then it immediately spikes to its best accuracy after that of 94.2, which is exactly what like stochastic gradient descent works and how it operates, right? So like this is like it crashed. And then so it's like completely awful. So it's like just go in the exact opposite direction of whatever caused that crash, right? And then, so that's exactly what it does. And then it starts doing a thing again, but then you can see here, like it's not internalizing, not learning anything within this algorithm. Like it's not a steady increase, right? The reason why backpropagation is so widely utilized and so widely performed, except like when you're training a model utilizing backpropagation, you can see the steady increase in performance. And in this instance, this MNIST is too easy for the traditional CNN model, but you can see here that the orange is their photon, right? And the photon spikes. And then, so this is the second thing that I want to point out. So if I ran this same experiment 100 times, out of those 100 times, I'm going to get a test where one of these spikes is going to spike higher than this blue line. Out of 100 tests, right? That's essentially what they're doing and then putting into these benchmarks in this paper here is my argument and my claim within this, because my experimentation with this algorithm doesn't support the high benchmarks that they're getting consistently. And they don't mention these as like consistent scores, right? These would be the highest score attained. And then so, yeah, like if I ran this test 100 times and I took the highest spike out of these, out of those 100 tests, there's going to be one spike that will be, in general, higher than this blue line. And then that's what they're reporting on within the research paper. But when you're looking at this, these accuracy spikes, these highs and these lows, this is indicative of a model that's not learning, right? The loss curve is not steadily going down, as I would typically and want to see on a model here. And the loss is good; it's below one, right? But like, look at the loss, the training loss with backpropagation. We're getting into double zeros, and then we don't even get into singular zero, and it doesn't go down like it should, right? Look at this. See, it starts at 0.0251, and then it ends at 0.0038. That's going. You can see a steady decrease of the loss, right? Like that's what I would want. That means it's learning. That's what backpropagation as an algorithm gives you, and that's not what this photon algorithm is giving you. And then so it's just not living up to the claims that they're making within this particular paper, right? And then again, just pointing that out, I see that way too often, and I understand 1,000,000% why people are starting to be, they should have been from the beginning, critical with regards towards any sort of claims when it comes to AI overall, right? Because anyone can make claims. And then, so that's why, for years at this point, throughout this channel, everything that I do around AI, it's experiment first, right? Like what can be proven out in the experiments? Because that's what is not up for debate, right? You can have your opinions, I can have my opinions, a third person can have their opinions, but an experimental test, and then what we're looking at here, like this collab notebook, you running through the experiments, you can do this yourself, you can increase the epochs, decrease the epochs, change certain things within this experiment, right? But experiments don't lie, and experiments are far less subjective than opinions overall. And then to me, that's how I try to look at these things overall and to try to cut through kind of the fat within it. And the other thing is that, like, to me, just calling it exactly what it is, and I think it's an approach that I think throws a lot of people off within this, is that I don't stay within one singular, like, body of my work, right? Like, so if I were to do that, like, I would still be talking about PFAF. Like that PFAF would be, like, the only thing that I talk about, right? And there's people, like, I see a lot of people, and I'm not going to name any sort of, like, individual frameworks or theories, but it's like, this is my framework and my theory that becomes my life, right? Like, the only thing that I am known for is this one theory, and that is it, right? And then, like, that's what leads to this, and then you're people trying to stake their claims on that overall. I would rather stake my claims overall on what works, what I can prove, and what I can prove experimentally over and over again, and, like, essentially, like, show me the money, right? Rather than trying to, and if something comes along that is better than what I have invented or come across overall, that's, to me, a win. that's for progress, right? And that's exactly how it should be. And if my hypotheses when I come up with something doesn't line up with the reality of the situation, then that means that there's something that I need to adjust within my hypothesis, which is good to me, right? Especially, like, as long as I'm getting, like, signal from my experiments. Like, if it's I expected it to be 95% plus accuracy in my experiments, and then I'm getting 80% accuracy, that means that there's still signal within there, but there's something within that signal that I'm missing, right? There's additional what is being currently picked up as noise, but is obviously not noise. I just need to figure out how to cut through and figure out how to measure that additional signal, is how I look at these things overall, right? And then, but so, yeah, like, not to pick on this particular research paper, but it caught my eye for what it is. And then when I ran through my experiments, like, it was very apparent to me that, they were exaggerating their benchmarks. And then, so I went through and then did my deep examination of the benchmarks after I went through and did my experience here overall. And then it, like, that's when it aligned with my hypothesis that, oh yeah, these guys are just severely and significantly inflating their benchmarks on this. And it shows overall, right? And then, so I don't, like, overall, bottom line to me, it's a cool algorithm. It doesn't solve for, and it doesn't outclass backpropagation. So backpropagation is still here to stay, which is like the benchmark within these things that has been set. And that's just how it is overall. But so I'll leave a link to both this research paper and this collab notebook. And if you like this type of content, please like and subscribe. Thank you very much.